Happy Sabbath. Happy birthday to me. Yeah. So it turns out that when you start living in Western New York, you tend to be cold. And I didn't know that. So, and when that happens, you age slower. So yes, Mitch, I am 30, but I look like a 16-year-old, right? No, the truth is, I'm 24. Amen, right? 24, right? And praise the Lord that I'm here, and thanks for being here on my birthday, and praise the Lord that we have an opportunity to worship Him today, and just thank you for coming. Let's have a word of prayer before we start diving into the Word of God. Let's pray. Dear Lord, be with us in a special way. Open our hearts, Lord. They may be really closed off to you, Lord, but we ask you to open our hearts, to soften our hearts, to defrost our hearts, and may we grow closer to you. We thank you, that, Lord, that doesn't matter how old we are, how young we are, but you can work in our lives today, and you can use us for your kingdom and for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Growing up, whenever I was sick, I would stay at home. Now, I really enjoyed the days I stayed at home because I could watch television. And one day, as I was watching television, I was watching the normal daily broadcast of the TV shows that go on. And this TV show came up, and the name of the TV show was, look at your bulletins real quick, and look at the sermon title. It gives you the answer right there. The name of the TV show was Judge Judy. And I remember watching this woman. She was a judge, and she was judging different cases where someone stole someone's dog or where someone didn't pay rent. And what does this have to do with the sermon? Well, give me a second. My father once got in an argument. He lent money to a coworker, and that coworker didn't give the money back. And I remember my dad would come back home, and he was so annoyed and so heated. And I remember he once received a letter from the studio, from a certain studio, and on the letterhead it said the name Judge Judy. Judge Judy had heard of my dad's argument with a certain coworker and was inviting my father to go to the TV show and to settle the case. I kid you not, this really happened. And we were so stoked, and my dad can barely speak English, so he didn't go on the TV show. But judges are found today, yes. I don't know if you've ever been called for jury duty, but judges still have authority in today's society. But turns out that in the Bible times, there were judges as well. You guys remember the name Solomon, right? He was a king, and he was a judge as well. But in our scriptures, we are told of another judge, of a bad judge. So let's turn our Bibles. Today, we're going to turn our Bibles to Luke. We're going to turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 18, verse 1. Luke chapter 18, verse 1. Luke chapter 18, verse 1 states, and he, as in Jesus, told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. Jesus told parables to the people to help them understand truths that God already knew. And this lesson is about a judge. And this judge isn't fair. This judge did not want good, but merely wanted to not be annoyed and pestered. And the story is about a judge who did a good thing for a good person for his own selfish remarks. Have you ever prayed and not have that answer and not have that prayer answered quickly? Have you ever prayed and thought to yourself, Lord, I'm asking you to do something, and in my life, I don't see that answer being worked out? Have you ever grown impatient with God? Have you ever grown annoyed at God? Now, if you were to say no, it's either one, you're too young and you don't understand life, or two, is that you're older and you already understand life, that our prayers are not always what? Answered quickly. And Jesus knew this exactly. He knew that people would grow impatient toward him. So Jesus said, how do I communicate to these people to not lose heart? And Jesus gives us this parable of an unjust judge. Verse 2 states, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. This judge did not have any regulations. This judge did not listen to man nor God. Therefore, this judge had no accountability to a human or to a deity. And whenever people do not have accountability, people tend to do whatever they want. And whatever they want, a lot of times ends up being selfish motives. Have you ever felt selfish? Have you ever wanted to do something that you wanted to do only for your own benefit? Now, if as Christians if we have this type of mentality, a selfish mentality, we don't completely understand the gospel. Now, you have to ask yourself, what is the gospel? The gospel is that man, that God, became human. He lost his powers, quote unquote powers, and he became human. Can you imagine the power that God has at his will? And can you imagine that power just quickly going away? Now, that's exactly what God did when he became human. He came in the form of a baby. Now, we all know the story of Jesus, of how he was born in swaddling clothes. But if you think about this, about Jesus becoming a baby, a human, in a poor city, Bethlehem, do you know that God did a trick play? Here in near Buffalo, we have the Buffalo Bills, and a trick play. If the Buffalo Bills were to ever do a trick play, they would be doing a play that would confuse the opponent, right? Well, when Jesus, hopefully, exactly. But when Jesus came as a baby, when he stripped himself of his glory and came as a baby in Bethlehem as a human, this play was a trick play against Satan, and Satan did not see that coming. Because for the first time ever, Jesus was vulnerable like a baby. But that's besides the point. The fact is that Jesus is not selfish. So when we have selfish desires, when we have selfish inclinations, what should we do? Should we harvest that selfish desire? Should we let it grow and permeate? No, we should cut it out. Because that's exactly what Jesus showed us when he came as a human for us. Let that grow in your heart. When we come here as a church together, we don't come here just to listen to a pastor preach, but we come here to encourage each other. So look at one another right now. Look at one another. Give a pat on the back to each other. Say, hey, I encourage you today. How many times does church become a weekly, a club, instead of a community of believers? Think about this. Have you guys communicated with each other throughout the week? Hey, have you guys encouraged each other throughout the week? If you haven't, I implore you guys to do that today. To not be selfish and to not act like the judge that we're about to read about. So we continue to read about this situation, this parable. Verse 3 states, "And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to the judge and saying, 'Give me justice against my adversary.' For a while, the judge refused." Scripture tells us about a woman, a widow, coming to this judge. And in Bible times, whenever a widow would come to a judge, the widow wouldn't be represented by a man. So that would mean that the widow would not have the same rights as a man. A lot of times we tend to think about Bible situations in our modern context. But that's not true. That's not the truth. Today we have social programs. We have government programs to help the widows. But this widow did not have anybody to represent her, to help her live. So when a woman became a widow, that woman would experience social and financial trauma and disparity. So Scripture tells us about an unjust judge, a selfish judge, and this judge is approached by a widow, by someone that in society isn't worth much. You would think that the judge would what? Dismiss her, right? Continually dismiss her. And that's what the judge did. The judge didn't care about this widow, about this woman. So the woman, what does she do? She continually goes back to that judge, tells the judge, "Help me, help me." And what does the judge do? Let's continue reading. The continuation of verse 4 states, "But afterward he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, so that she will beat me, that she will not beat me down by her continual coming.'" After all the pleading that the widow did for that judge, it worked. She got what she needed. Wouldn't that be good? Put yourself in that situation. Put yourself in the widow situation, in her sandals or shoes today. If you know that the judge does not want to help you, and eventually the judge does help you, how would you feel? Relieved. Good. Now, it doesn't stop there. Jesus makes a connection with that unjust judge with who? With God. We read in verse 6, it states, "And the Lord said, 'Hear what the unrighteous judge says. And will not God give you justice to his elect who cry to him day and night?'" Mercy. Christ compares the selfish judge to God. Now, if you can believe a story of a judge, a selfish judge, being willing to work with a widow, when we go to God, when we, as children of God, go to him, should we expect that God is going to listen to our prayers and needs? Absolutely. If a selfish judge could grant a widow something, can't God, our Father, grant us the prayers that we ask him to grant? I got to hear an amen. Yeah. We really have to understand this, because we forget that we have a just God. Now, the thing is, a lot of people say, well, if I want a Mercedes, and I pray to God, "I want a Mercedes, Lord, and I trust that you're a good judge," And I pray, and after I open my eyes and the Mercedes isn't in the driveway, then that means that God is not just. But the thing is, this may seem like an absurd idea, but we continually do that to God at times. God will answer our prayers, but we have to be willing to look for His will. Do you trust God with your life? Yes. Do you trust the Lord with your life? So when you go to Him and the prayer isn't answered, or the answer is delayed, have faith that the Lord is still with you. Know that the Lord is still with you. There's a lot of times, my friends, we lose heart with God because we don't think He answers our prayers. But continually go to Him, even when the going gets rough. Because aren't we blessed to be here today? Amen. Aren't we blessed to walk? Amen. Have you ever been sick that you can't even walk and all you want is to eat well and to feel well? Well, today we have the opportunity to walk and breathe and be here today. Praise the Lord for that. But if you are going through a difficult situation, I ask you to go to the Lord continually. Don't stop going to the Lord. Be with the Lord. And do not lose patience with the Lord. Each time I leave my house, I have to put my puppy in his kennel, or I have to make sure that the house isn't a mess so he doesn't get in trouble. But each time I leave the house, how does my dog feel? What does he do? My dog gets super anxious. But why? He's seen me leave plenty of times and times and times again. But the reason he gets anxious is because he doesn't understand that I will come back. Now, I hate to compare ourselves to a dog, but a lot of times we do not trust God enough where we essentially forget that He is faithful. Shouldn't my dog understand that I am faithful to him, that I'll get him his good food and etc.? Yes, he can. But does he have the capability to? Probably not. But we do. We have the capability to know that God is righteous. He is continually there for us, and He will never forsake us. But we forget that. We tend to forget that. But know that our Father is continually there for us and always waiting for us. The Lord is always faithful. But who is the one that tends to be unfaithful? Us. But continually go to Him. Ask Him to impact your life in a special and an impactful way. Verse 7 continues saying, "Will He delay long over them? I tell you, as in Jesus tells you, He will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will He find faith on earth?" Here Jesus challenges His hearers to have faith in the Lord, even when it gets tough, even when you think that He is not coming. Ask the Lord to give you that belief to endure life. Because life is not easy. Life is not easy. There are plenty of people my age who grew up in the church always hearing that Jesus is coming, that Jesus is coming. And they look back on generations of Adventists, of other Christians who have said that Jesus is coming. And we find ourselves on April 9th, 2016, here in this church, and we say that Jesus is coming. And a lot of people can find that repetitive, but do not think that it is repetitive, my friends. Have patience with the Lord, because the Lord does not want to, the Lord is not late to His date. The Lord is not late to His second coming, but have faith that He is coming very soon. And the thing is that Christ is righteous. And remember that God will be our righteous judge. Now, when you commune with the Lord, you become friends, you become a father-son relationship, daughter, whatever, no, father, yeah, daughter-father relationship, whatever it may be. But when you're with the Lord, you have a special bond, a time with the Lord. You become family. Now, we all know that judgment is coming, right? Or judgment is here, right? But, you know, when I say judgment, a lot of us tend to get a little like, ugh, why is he talking about judgment? But know that judgment is good when there is no fault found in you. And when you're with Christ, when you dealt with Christ continually, when you go to Christ every single day, know that no fault will be found in you because Jesus paid it off for you. Because Christ is your lawyer, and he has never lost a case. And remember that the judge found in this case is the father of the lawyer. So no matter what, we're in good hands, and the bias is for your favor. Praise the Lord for that. A few weeks ago, I spoke about a story of a man named Jerry. You guys remember that? I don't know if you guys remember. I left it on a cliffhanger. Well, Jerry, let me tell you this. Jerry lived in a place in a paradise called Chattanooga, Tennessee. Let that sink in a little bit, okay? He lived in Chattanooga, Tennessee. This is a real story. Jerry was a Seventh-day Adventist. He's still alive today. Seventh-day Adventist living in 1970s. Jerry grew up in the Northwest, and eventually he got married in Maryland. His first marriage, he had a divorce in his first marriage. So then he moved out of Maryland and went to Tennessee. And in Tennessee, he met a woman named Darlene. They got married, and he now finds himself in his second marriage. Now, Jerry is a private investigator. And Jerry started his own company and has a partner named George. Now, Jerry and George work together to solve certain investigations. And as their secretary, they have Jerry's wife, Darlene. Are we still together?
Yeah.
Okay. So one day, Jerry was sleeping in his house. His office was close to his house. He was sleeping there, and he is approached by his wife. And on his wife's face is this ghost expression. Have you ever seen an expression like that? Darlene is in shock, and she's coming to George, and George was waking up from a nap out of it. And now Jerry finds himself with his wife, who is acting like a frantic woman. And Jerry asks Darlene, Darlene, what happened? How can I help you? And she says, George, he is unconscious. And Jerry's like, where is he unconscious? So Darlene leads Jerry to their office. And in their office, it was a two-story office. They had a staircase. And there at the bottom of the staircase lay George, not moving and unconscious. Jerry goes to George and tries to wake him up, move him around, but he is stone cold. George is dead. And Jerry's a private investigator. He knows what police will do if they come into the scene. So Jerry asks Darlene, what happened? What happened? And Darlene says, well, he was drinking. I was in the office and he was in his office. And he tried to touch me. So I fought him back. I pushed him and he fell down the stairs. So Jerry feels he's shocked. He's like, then did my wife commit murder? You know, there's a lot of things, a lot of holes, a lot of things that are kind of vague. So the thing is, though, that Jerry that Jerry had his second marriage. And after the failure of his first marriage, Jerry felt that he had to prove himself as a husband. He had to prove to Darlene, to Darlene's family, and to his own family that he was capable of being a husband. So Jerry feels like, well, I have to fix what? The situation. So quickly, Jerry makes an alibi in his mind. He makes his own story up that George was in the office by himself and that he tripped and fell down. And then Darlene and George and Jerry came into the office and they found George dead. So then they fix the scene up to make George seem like he fell in an awkward position, and they found him there, and then they would call the police and bring him over to investigate. So they did that. They moved George's dead body around. They fixed him up, and he's a private investigator. They fixed him up. Darlene and Jerry both said, okay, this is our story, and when they come to interrogate us, we will not tell them. No, we will tell them this story, and we will all be safe. So the police show up. They find the body. They start asking for, you know, when did you find him? How do you know him? Do you know that he drinks? When was the last time you saw him? And etc. But the thing is that Jerry forgot one vital piece of evidence. While he was moving the body, what got on his shirt? No, not just that, but blood. So when they investigated him, when they brought him into downtown, into the police department, they noticed that he had blood. They noticed that the stories didn't add up well. And in a few months' notice, Jerry found himself convicted of murder and serving a 99-year sentence in Knoxville prison. As Jerry is going through this situation, he doesn't know how to process everything. So a lot of times when we hit rock bottom, we tend to look up. And we tend to look for God. And Jerry knew that he had not committed the crime, but turns out that his wife Darlene at the end went against Jerry and helped convict Jerry to go into the jail, into prison. One day, as he's struggling with being in prison, he is called by his wife, and his wife tells him, Jerry, I never loved you. I don't care for you. Stop talking to me, and we won't talk to each other anymore. Click. And that was it. Can you imagine being in jail for 16 years, paying the price for a crime he didn't commit all the way, right? But being told by his wife, his ex-wife by now, that he did not matter to her. And for the next 16 years, we find Jerry stuck in prison, and he is going through all the case files because he knew that he didn't commit the murder. He goes through the case files, and after a few years, he asks for a retrial. Now, I don't know if you guys are aware with the prison system, but you can ask for a retrial if there's new evidence that is brought up. But by this time, Darlene had become good friends with who? With all the lawyers, all the defense attorneys, all the district attorneys, and the judges in the area. And this is like a soap opera, but it's true. Darlene made all the judges go against our friend Jerry. Now, after several years, Jerry appealed to the Supreme Court, I believe, and for some reason, he got in contact with a judge that he had not been able to get in contact before. And after 16 years, 16 long years of being in prison, He was given a retrial, and he was given freedom. Amen? And Jerry can only give the credit to his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jerry now says that he was shown grace. He was shown grace to him, to his life, not just for his present state, but to his spiritual life. Jerry was put in the hands of an unjust judge or judges. And now, when he was put in front of those unjust judges, he went to the heavenly judge. He went to God, our ultimate judge. And he went to him and he confessed his sins. And he asked for grace. And that grace empowered him to grow closer to him. And eventually empowered him for his will to keep fighting for his freedom. Don't you want that kind of grace in your life? Don't you want to know that when salvation, when the real matters come up, when our eternal lives are a matter of life and death, that we have a righteous judge? Amen? Aren't you glad about that? Do you want to accept that? Do you want to accept Christ as your judge, Christ and God as your righteous judge, and Christ as your lawyer? Do you want to accept that? Raise your hand. Aren't you glad that we have a righteous judge, right? Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're shown grace. You show us grace to us. Being a righteous judge, you always are there for us, Lord. Be with us, Lord, as we depart from this church. And thank you for the stories of Jerry, of Jairus Bragan. That if you can work in his life, Lord, and he can have this spiritual renewal, and life, you can give us that today. Lord, help us to not hit rock bottom to finally understand, Lord, but work in our hearts today to understand how you love us so much and that you care for us, and that for that reason, we must commune with you. We pray this in the beautiful name of Jesus. Amen.